calculus is about change. Not that kind of change. What kind of change then? Continuous and smooth changes of variables, not abrupt changes. Imagine smoothly flowing water, or a bead moving smoothly along a thin wire. To be more official about it, we could say that calculus is the science of continuous change. In math, the most common way to study change is with functions. We say that functions model change. Functions are said to be given by rules. Oftentimes, these are formulas. For example, a common function is this one, y equals f of x equals x squared. The letter f represents the function name, the letter x is called the independent variable, the input, and the letter y is called the dependent variable, the output. The x to the second power, or x squared, is the rule or formula. It tells you how to find the output y when you know the input x. The function f can be imagined to be a machine. It takes an input, such as x equals 3, and transforms it into an output, f of 3 equals 3 squared equals 9. Let's look at what we just did again. We were evaluating the function. In other words, finding an output for a given input. When the input x equals 3, we substitute that into the function to get the output y equals f of 3 equals 3 squared equals 9. We strive to understand functions in their totality by making graphs. Graphs are where we visualize many outputs for many inputs. To make a graph, start with a table of values. The first row here represents different values of the independent variable x, the input, and the second row represents the corresponding values of the dependent variable y, the output. When x is negative 3, the output is 9. When x is negative 2, the output is 4, etc. We then plot these points in a Cartesian rectangular coordinate system and connect the dots with a smooth curve. The final picture shows the overall behavior of the function. As x increases, y decreases before increasing again, and overall, the graph is shaped like a bowl. We say it's concave up. As with any topic in math, we want to start simple. What are the simplest kinds of functions? They're called linear functions. Before getting into the formulas that linear functions have, let's consider a practical example. Suppose car rental A has a base cost of $100 and a $50 charge per day, while car rental B has a base cost of $10 and a $75 charge per day. By what day will rental B cost more than rental A? Rental B costs more per day, so you would think eventually it's going to catch up to rental A. These costs can be represented as functions of the number of days. But before we write formulas for these costs, let's look for numerical patterns. For the function c equals a of x, the cost of rental A as a function of the number of days, we have this table. When x is 0, we've just taken out the rental, the cost is $100. That's the base cost. After one day, we have a $50 charge per day, so our total cost is up to $150. After 2 days, we have 2 days of $50 charges, so our total cost is up to $200. And after 3 days, we have three $50 charges, so our total cost is up to $250. On the other hand, for car rental B, the cost B of X is given by this table. When we just rent the car at time zero, the cost is $10, that's the base charge. After 1 day, we add on another $75 for a total of $85. After 2 days, we add on 2 times 75 for a total of $160. And after 3 days, we add on 3 times 75 for a total of $235. You can see these numbers are getting closer together. It looks like by the 4th day, car rental B will cost more than car rental A. Let's confirm this answer with formulas, algebra, and graphs. The cost of rental A is a function of x, the number of days. There's the base cost of $100 when you rent the car, plus the per day charge, $50 per day times x days. The days cancel, leaving you with a simplified formula, 100 plus 50x dollars. On the other hand, for rental B, the cost is a function B of x, whose base cost is $10 and whose per day charge is $75 per day. Once again, we can cancel the days and we are left with a simplified formula of 10 plus 75x dollars. Now let's use algebra to solve for x. Set these two functions equal to each other. Set a of x equal to b of x. This means that 100 plus 50x equals 10 plus 75x. This is a linear equation in x. We can solve it for x by isolating x. For example, we could strive to get x on the right side by itself and any numbers not involving x on the left side by themselves. We could subtract 50x from both sides and subtract 10 from both sides. Whatever is done to one side of the equation has to be done to the other side as well to balance it out. This will cancel the 50x on the left side and cancel the 10 on the right side, giving us 90 equals 25x. 100 minus 10 is 90, and 75x minus 50x is 25x. Now x will be solved for if I divide both sides by 25. It will cancel on the right, and then I need to balance that by dividing it also on the left. This leads to the solution x equals 90 over 25, which is 3.6 days, which we can round up to 4 days. However, you might wonder, if we had gotten x equal to 3.4 days, would we want to round that down to 3 days? You might want to pause the video and think about it. In fact, you may want to think about what the natural domains of these functions should be. Should we be allowed to plug in any number for x? Let's now approach the same problem graphically. We'll start by expanding our table of values from before, and also show the function formulas. Rental A has cost formula A of x equals 100 plus 50x, and rental B has cost formula B of x equals 10 plus 75x. These are the same data points as before, but we've added a new one at day 4 when x is 4, A of 4 is $300, and B of 4 is $310. Rental B costs more than rental A. As we've noted before, A of x increases by $50 every day that goes by. More generically, we say A of x increases by 50 units for every 1 unit increase of x. The rate of change of A of x with respect to x is 50. It's a constant. That is a characteristic of linear functions. In a similar way, since B of x is linear, its rate of change is also constant. B of x increases by 75 units for every 1 unit increase of x. We can then plot these points in a coordinate system whose axes are labeled with the days and the cost. Assuming these functions are defined for all values of x, we then connect the dots with straight lines. The point where these graphs cross, their point of intersection, corresponds to the algebraic solution for when these functions have equal outputs. X equals 3.6 was what we found for the solution of the algebra problem. That's the value of x when these two continuous functions with no breaks in their graphs have equal outputs of 280. However, for the real-life practical problem, we rounded the solution x equals 3.6 up to 4 to find the first day when rental B costs more than rental A. In reality, the true cost functions are what are called step functions. More about that later. For the moment, let's focus on the graph of A of x in order to see how we can find a formula for a linear function in general. Notice that if we draw a right triangle in the picture as shown, the rate of change of the cost with respect to the number of days, $50 per day, can be represented as the ratio of the lengths of the sides of the triangle. It's also called the slope, 50 over 1 equals 50. If we pick a different right triangle, like this one, it will be similar to the original one with the same angles and the same corresponding ratios of lengths of sides. In this case, the ratio is 100 over 2, which still simplifies to $50 per day. Here's another example of a right triangle that's similar to the other ones. The ratio is still the same. The slope still simplifies to $50 per day. This observation leads us to a general approach for finding formulas for linear functions when you're given two data points. For the function c equals a of x, we can label the coordinates of the first data point x1, c1. C1 corresponds to the function value a of x1. We can, for example, take x1 to be 1, and the coordinates would become 1, a of 1. We want that to equal the data point 1, 150. The second data point is labeled x2, c2. C2 is found by evaluating the function a at the number x2. We can, for example, take x2 to be 4. Then the coordinates are 4, a of 4, and we can set that equal to the data point 4, 300. As we saw in the plot, it doesn't matter which two distinct data points you pick, you'll still get the same slope. The change in the cost divided by the change in x, indicated by delta c over delta x, the triangle-shaped symbol being the Greek letter delta, which is shorthand for change in, ultimately equals 300 minus 150 divided by 4 minus 1, which is 150 over 3, which is 50. And again, you'll get the same answer of $50 per day, no matter which two distinct data points you pick. This leads to the formula being of the form c equals a of x equals 50x plus some unknown constant b, which we already know is going to be 100, but let's figure it out. What we can do is we can pick either data point. I happen to pick the point 1, 150. We can replace x with 1 and c with 150 and solve for b. Subtract 50 from both sides and get b is 150 minus 50, which was 100. Then the final answer is c equals a of x equals 50x plus 100. In general, if we're using a linear function, y equals f of x equals either b plus mx or mx plus b. It doesn't matter because addition is commutative. We call this the slope-intercept form of the function or the equation of a line. The letter m represents the slope of the function. It's also the rate of change of y with respect to x. It's often written as the ratio rise divided by run, or rise over run for short. If your two points are x1, y1 and x2, y2, the rise is y2 minus y1 and the run is x2 minus x1. And this can be written with capital delta notation as delta y divided by delta x. The value of b is also the y-intercept, where the graph of this function crosses the y-axis. It also can be thought of as the initial value of y, the value of y when x equals 0, f of 0, and it turns out to equal y1 minus m times x1 when you plug in the first data point. It would also equal y2 minus m times x2 when you plug in the second data point. Let's do an example. Here's a couple data points. x1, y1 equals negative 5, 7. And x2, y2 equals 3, negative 5. The first point is to the left of the second point in the plane. However, the roles of these points could be switched around. It's not a problem. Start by finding m, the slope. It's rise over run. We could also write that as delta y over delta x, or y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. If you plug in the numbers, you get negative 5 minus 7 equals negative 12 on the top, and 3 minus negative 5 equals positive 8 on the bottom. Negative 12 divided by positive 8 is negative 3 halves, or negative 1.5. If you had reversed the roles of the points, you would have gotten positive 12 over negative 8, which is still negative 3 halves, or negative 1.5. Now find the intercept b. It's y1 minus m times x1. Plug in y1 equals 7. Plug in m is negative 3 halves, and x1 equals negative 5. Simplify, you get 14 halves minus 15 halves, which is negative 1 half, or negative 0.5. The final answer is y equals f of x equals negative 1.5x minus 0.5. You should check my work, and you should also check that you get the same answer for b if you use the point x2, y2 instead. Here's a graphical depiction of the solution. You can see the two points, negative 5, 7, and 3, negative 5. You can see the run is 8, the rise is negative 12, this function is decreasing. The red line goes down as x moves to the right. The slope m is negative 3 halves, which is negative 1.5, and the y-intercept b equals negative 1 half, which is negative 0.5. That's where the graph crosses the y-axis. In general, you can see that when the slope is positive, the function is increasing, and when the slope is negative, the function is decreasing. The slope is also a measure of steepness. The bigger a positive slope is, the faster the graph increases. The further a negative slope is from zero, the faster the graph decreases. Once again, b, the y-intercept, tells you where the graph crosses the y-axis. It is the initial value of the function at x equals zero. We assumed linear functions had a constant rate of change to derive their formulas. We should also verify the reverse. We should verify that linear functions have a constant rate of change equal to the slope based on their formula. What is delta y over delta x? It's f of x2 minus f of x1 all over x2 minus x1. If we use the fact that f of x is mx plus b and replace x with x2 in the first spot and x1 in the second spot, we get this expression. We can distribute the minus sign through the parentheses to get this expression, and then we can cancel the b's to get this. Then we can factor out an m to get this, and finally we can cancel the x2 minus x1 in both the top and the bottom to simplify to the slope m. This is true no matter what distinct numbers x1 and x2 are. A very important subclass of linear functions, which has many applications, is the topic of direct proportionalities. We say that y is directly proportional to x if there is a constant k such that y equals f of x equals k times x. Yes, k is the slope here, it is the rate of change, and b, the y-intercept, is zero. The graph of such a function will indeed go through the origin. Here are a couple examples of direct proportionalities to physics and finance. In the case of physics, distance traveled is directly proportional to time of travel and constant rate of travel, a constant speed. The equation is distance equals rate times time, which you can write as d equals r times t. If the rate is constant, you can think of time as the independent variable, and if the time is constant, you can think of the rate as the independent variable. Either way is okay. In finance, simple interest that is earned on an account is directly proportional to the principal, which is the deposit amount, the interest rate, and the amount of time of the investment. This is often written as I equals P times R times T. If time happens to be in years, it's understood that R is in percent per year, though that percent, such as 4%, would be converted to a decimal, such as 0.04, before using this formula. Here's a simple example of a direct proportionality problem. Suppose that y is directly proportional to x, and that y equals 12 when x equals 3. What is the value of y when x equals 9? Here's the solution. Start by assuming y equals f of x equals k times x. We first need to plug in the numbers to figure out what k is, and once we've done that, we can solve the problem. We replace y with 12 and x with 3, and get 12 equals 3 times k. Next, divide both sides by 3 to get k equals 12 over 3, which is 4. Then, plug that in for k. The function is really y equals f of x equals 4 times x. Now replace x with 9. The final answer is y equals f of 9 equals 4 times 9 equals 36. Something interesting happened in that example. Notice that y tripled in value from 12 to 36 when x tripled in value from 3 to 9. For direct proportionalities, this observation generalizes to any value of x and any factor by which x increases, whether it doubles, triples, quadruples, quintuples, etc. We can verify this symbolically as follows. Suppose f of x equals k times x, pretend x1 is some specific number, like 3, and let y1 equal f of x1. By the formula for f, that's k times x1. If x1 is 3 and k is 4, then y1 is 4 times 3, which equals 12. Next, suppose that x2 equals c times x1. X1 doubling in value is when c is 2, x1 tripling in value is when c is 3, and x1 quadrupling in value is when c is 4. Let y2 equal f of x2. Since x2 is c times x1, that becomes f of c times x1. Since the formula for f of x is k times x, replace x with c times x1 to get k times the quantity c times x1. It's really important at this point to not be confused by this notation. F is a function name. It's not a number. It's not being multiplied by c times x1. Instead, c times x1 is being plugged into f. However, k is a number. It is being multiplied by c times x1. Because of that fact, we can use properties of algebra, the associative property and the commutative property, to write this as c times the quantity k times x1. Why is that beneficial? Because that's also the same as c times y1. In other words, when x1 gets multiplied by c to get x2, y1 gets multiplied by c to get y2. If c is 2, this corresponds to both values doubling. If c is 3, this corresponds to both values tripling. And if c is 4, this corresponds to both values quadrupling. We end lesson 1.1 of Calculus 1 with a reality check. If we go back to our application of the car rentals, the formulas that we derived really do not work for all x. The main issue is, how are partial days charged? Probably the most common way this is done is for a full charge for partial days. Here is the graph in that situation. Both a of x and b of x are piecewise functions. In fact, they're called step functions. I'll leave it to you to think about this, but do notice that b of x, the red graph, is finally bigger than a of x, the blue graph, once x gets strictly bigger than 3 days. On the other hand, if there's no charge for partial days, then the two graphs look like this, and the b of x red graph only gets bigger than the a of x blue graph once x is greater than or equal to 4. It's a different answer. Which one is right? It depends on what happens in reality. Are there full charges for partial days or no charges for partial days? Thanks for watching Lesson 1.1 of Calculus 1.